And tonight we are pleased to have Pastor James Dewhurst and his wife Tiffany from Real Church with us here at the IFM Fall Conference. Pastor James and Tiffany have led youth ministries for most of their careers, starting here in Ohio and then in Georgia. They've also produced a couple of albums, I believe, praise God, and spoken at many conferences throughout their years of service. They also have raised two children, Malachi and Melina, before returning to Ohio and starting Real Church in 2013. In just a few short years, Real Church in Pataskala has grown from an idea and a call and a whisper from the Lord to more than 400 attendees across two different services each Sunday. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Reaching the community for Jesus. Pastor James began with an associate degree in biblical theology. He received his bachelor's in Christian counseling, and just in the last, month, maybe, or so, he attained his master's in practical theology. So not only does he have experience, but he has some good education. God has truly blessed Pastor James. He has an energetic approach to proclaiming the gospel, and he shows and tells how to apply it in our everyday lives. Lord, let's just all give it up for Pastor James. Come on up. Thank you so much. God bless you.
You introduced me better than I'm going to preach. What am I supposed to do?
I told her, I said, she introduced me better than I might preach. I don't know what to do with all that. That was rather impressive. Thank you, Courtney. I'd show up and hear me preach too if I was actually that awesome. So you buttered me up a little bit. Thank you so much. Greatly appreciate the privilege and honor of being here tonight. And I'm gonna make sure I don't lose my notes there. I'm gonna change a couple of things. That's gonna fall off. So let's fix that. Good to see you all. Who's excited to be in the house of the Lord? We got any excited Christians to be here? Well, listen, it is an honor and a privilege to be here tonight, and I'll tell you, I made one person a little disappointed, and I have to be honest with you, that's my daughter. She is a soccer player, among other things, and I'm her coach, and I had to skip coaching tonight and miss her game, and so I was getting text messages a little bit earlier, but if you could throw up that picture of our family, do you have that or no? It probably is. There we go. Yeah, so this is, I just want to introduce them. So my wife didn't make it because she's on the sidelines of the soccer field. All the way on the right is my wife. We celebrate 21 years tomorrow. All right, that's pretty awesome. And then that's me, and then that's my 12-year-old amazing daughter, Melina, who is, I'm just so proud of her. I love her to pieces, and she's a singer and a worshiper. She's learned to play piano and a bunch of cool stuff, so we love that. And then we don't know what happened to the guy there. He passed all of us up. We were feeding him something, the hormones and the food. I don't know what's going on, but that's my eldest son, Malachi, and he is, come on, God's messenger, Malachi. We got to get some of that right there, and he just signed a basketball scholarship, and he's going playing basketball and go to school at Ohio Christian University down in Circleville. And so, yeah. So I just wanted to introduce you to my family so you knew who we were, and what an honor and a privilege. Thank you, Bishop, for having me and inviting me. It's a privilege to be here. By the way, is he not one of the nicest, coolest guys to hang around on the planet? I mean, just cool as a cucumber, man. Yeah, I see y'all. And thank you, Pastor Tim, and your wife as well, for hosting this and having us here tonight. It's an honor and a privilege to be here. So we're going to jump in, and I'm going to preach a word. We have been in a series as a church for the past 3 weeks, and we're going to finish it up Sunday. And I was wrestling through, what do I preach and what do I share? And I felt like the Lord laid on my heart to share one of the messages that I've recently shared at our church because of the topic and because of what it's addressing. The title of your conference, the theme was "The Time Is Now," and I've titled the message tonight, "It's Time to Stand on Truth." It's the time is now. It's time to stand on truth, and so we're going to get into that. Before we do, I always try to do something funny at our church, and I have to be me, so I'm going to try to share a little story with you. There was a pastor, he was 10 minutes into his Sunday sermon on a Sunday morning, and he looked up and he noticed his young son sitting in the balcony with a pea shooter. He was leaning over the balcony, and one after another, he was popping people right in the back of the head, just, you know, just nailing them, bam, one after another. Pastor started getting frustrated. I mean, he's trying to preach, and his son's losing his mind up there, you know, and it's supposed to be an example, you know, pastor kids, all that stuff, you know the stigma. And right as the pastor, I mean, he reaches his height of frustration. He reaches this fuming point, and he's getting prepared to deliver a public rebuke to his son in front of the entire congregation, which he doesn't want to do, but he's got to. Right at the moment where he's getting ready to speak, his 7-year-old son hollers out, "Hey, Dad, you keep preaching, and I'll keep them all awake." So here's the deal, okay? I'm going to do my best not to need a pea shooter tonight, okay? I'm going to do my best. But listen, you can come on. But y'all got to help me out, okay? So if I'm going to preach good, you got to talk good. Is that okay? If I'm and by the way, if you can't tell, I got a little soul up in me. Is it okay if I share the soul tonight? Can I give you all a little soul up in here? See, people told me my whole life, I'm light on the outside, but I'm dark on the inside. And so I'm going to have a little church with my friends. So let's bow our heads for the word of opening prayer. Father, we thank you for your goodness and grace. We ask that your spirit would be here. And Lord, as I speak forth your word, God, I pray that you'd use me as a vessel. Cleanse my heart and mind. Help me, Father, to have nothing in my heart or mind, God, that would keep you from moving freely in this room. God, I pray that you'd speak, that you'd deliver, Father, that you'd reveal, God, that you'd empower, God, that you'd encourage, God, that you'd set free, God, that you'd motivate in the mighty name of Jesus. And all of God's people said,
amen.
Okay, you're getting good. You're getting good. Well, I'd like to start tonight by talking to us about standing on truth in a changing culture. How many of y'all realize the culture's changing, and it's changing real fast? I mean, super, super fast. I'm going to talk to you a little bit for a few minutes about Daniel. I'll give you a little backstory about Daniel and the time of Daniel, Babylon was much like the United States of America is today. I'm going to give you a little parallel if I could. It was not only the most powerful and successful empire in the world at the time, this Babylon, but it also became the cultural center of the entire world. People came from everywhere because it was strategically located between the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers, and it became this trade port, this diverse trade route where ships would come and go, and people from all cultures and walks of life would show up. And under the 43-year reign of the king Nebuchadnezzar, the empire expanded by force. They were strong, and they just started taking land from people, kicking butt and taking names. We'll just say it like that. That's what they were doing. And guess what? Jerusalem was in their path. And they conquered Jerusalem. And the Hebrew people were taken captive under King Nebuchadnezzar. All of Judah was forced to move from the land and the city and the culture that they knew. And they had to transplant themselves. Pack your bags. You're moving, whether you want to or not. And they had to move over to Babylon. Along with plundering the city and the Jewish people, the Jewish temple itself was plundered. They took things out of the temple, and King Nebuchadnezzar's soldiers and people transported articles of worship that were meant for God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob only. Those articles were transferred over, and they were put into the Babylonian temple, right, where there were many gods and many false things. It became an article of worship for many instead of the article for the one and only true God, and that's what had happened on that day. Nebuchadnezzar took 4 of Jerusalem's finest young men. He said, you know what we're going to do? We're going to make our kingdom stronger. So we're going to look through all of the Hebrews, and we're going to decide which ones are the smartest and the sharpest. And we're going to take them, and we're going to train them in our ways, and we're going to put them in our leadership and government so that we can continue to be strong and rule the world. So 4 of these Hebrews went into a 3-year Babylonian school. They went into this university, as it were, and they were trained to serve in the Babylonian kingdom. They were taught new languages. They were taught a new religion. They were taught new cultural practices, and they were even given a new diet. You're going to eat from the king's table. You're not going to eat what everybody else eats. You're going to eat from the king's table. It's interesting. Very interesting. Sounds good, but maybe it isn't. It was in the beginning days of this Babylonian indoctrination when a Hebrew named Daniel rose up. I'm going to read to you the story. And forgive me for reading lots of verses, but I'm preaching from the Bible, so I'm going to give a lot of scripture tonight. I don't know about you, but you didn't come for my opinion. You came for the word. And so Daniel chapter 1, verse 1 says, in the third year of the reign of King Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came in to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the articles from the temple of God. These he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia and put in the treasure house of his God. And then the king ordered Ashpenaz, chief of the court officials, to bring into the king's service some of the Israelites from the royal family and nobility, young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude for every kind of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. Sounds like I'm describing some people in the room tonight. You can shout me down. I knew I'd have somebody claim that. Okay, that's me, Pastor. That's me. He was to teach them the language and the literature of the Babylonians. The king assigned them a daily amount of food and wine from the king's table. And they were to be trained for 3 years. And after that, they were to enter the king's service. Among those who were chosen were some from Judah: Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Or you know them as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The chief official gave them new names. Come on, y'all need to watch out for people that try to rename you. We'll talk about that in a moment, because the world will try to rename you. You need to know that. To Daniel, the name Belshazzar, to Hananiah, Shadrach, to Mishael, Meshach, and to Azariah, Abednego. But Daniel resolved. Everybody say, but Daniel resolved. Don't forget that line. But Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and the wine, and he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself this way. Now God had caused the official to show favor and compassion to Daniel, but the official told Daniel, I'm afraid, because here's what I'm worried about. I'll not let you have to eat the king's food, but if you come in looking frail and weak and all messed up, eyes sunken in, you know, having that bedhead, you walk in like that, listen, the king's going to take my life because you're not eating what you're supposed to be eating. It's a true story. So he said, I'm afraid of the Lord my king. Why should he see you looking worse than all the other young men your age? The king would have my head because of you. And then Daniel said to the guard whom the chief official had appointed over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, please do me a favor. Just test your servant for 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Y'all know the Daniel fast. This is where it started. It got birthed right here because somebody resolved, okay? You just got to resolve and things happen. And verse 13, then compare our appearance with that of all the other young men in the kingdom who eat from the royal food. You compare our appearance to theirs and treat your servants in accordance to what you see. So he agreed to this and he tested them for 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, they looked healthier and better nourished than any of the other young men who ate the royal food. So the guard took away their choice food and wine that they were to drink and gave them vegetables instead. To these four young men, God gave knowledge and understanding of all kinds of literature and learning. And Daniel could understand visions and dreams of all kinds. At the end of the time set by the king to bring them into his service, the chief official presented them to Nebuchadnezzar. And the king talked with them. Oh, here's the test. Come on. And he found none equal. Come on, somebody, to Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. So they entered the king's service. Can I tell you, God always blesses people who stand on their convictions. Can I just tell you right now, he protects them. He makes them healthy. He looks after them. Come on. He covers them on the rear side. Come on, somebody, you hearing me tonight? And much like what is happening in our world today, can I tell you, everything changed around Daniel, didn't it? Everything changed around him. I'm going to tell you about what changed. In 605 BC, after Daniel was taken captive at his new homeland, the values all around him immediately changed. The value system changed. The decrees of God that Daniel had held so sacred all of his life were now in this new land treated as common. I mean, we don't really care what you do over in Jerusalem. You know, we don't, come on, you people of Judah, we really don't care what you do and how you serve. Let me tell you what we do over here. You're going to do what we do. And in this new Babylonian religious melting pot, all these religions and beliefs were just kind of mixed all together, all muddied up. Y'all know that's what's happening in our world today. People are trying to say things like, we all worship the same God, just with a different name. How many of y'all know that's not true? Amen? It's not true. It's not true. It's changing, but it's not true. Daniel's political, cultural, and social climate changed as well, as Nebuchadnezzar, a king who had no accountability to God whatsoever, created an environment of idolatry and paganism. Wow. Daniel's name was changed along with three of his Hebrew friends for the purpose. You want to know why they changed their names? For the purpose of stripping them of their Hebrew identity. Oh, come on. To rename them the property of Babylon. I tell you, I want you to know, church, the world is trying to rename Christians. They're trying to call them hateful. You know, they're trying to say they're this, they're that, they're the other. You know, you stand on truth and they try to throw mud at you. They try to call you by a different name. Don't let anybody change your name. Daniel's education changed as he was forced into a university to learn a new language, a new worldview that was contrary to that of the scriptures. Daniel's diet also changed as he was commanded to eat food from the king's table. The problem was, you said, why would you stand up and have an issue with that? I mean, the king's food's got to be good, right? It's got to taste good. It probably tastes good. But the problem was the king's food was sacrificed to idols before it was served. Do you hear that? See, Daniel said, I'm sorry, but I serve the one true God. I can't eat food from your table. You know what I'm saying? I can't do it. And see, that's why he stood up. Y'all understand the world is also trying to feed us things that we can't eat. You know what I'm saying? Because he's got meat to eat that we know not of. And I don't need to eat your meat. According to Hebrew law, it was unclean for Daniel to partake. And he said, I'm sorry, I can't do it. Imagine just for a moment. I mean, just think for a moment. This Daniel standing up to the most powerful king in the most powerful kingdom on the planet. And he said, no. I mean, just put yourself in those, just for a moment. No, I'm sorry. I'm not going to do that. Powerful, powerful. Can I just say this to you? You can't live on the world's diet and expect to bear heaven's fruit. Can I just say that tonight? We can't be eating the things of the world and expect to bear heavenly fruit. It doesn't work that way. We've got to eat, come on, the right kind of stuff. Something incredible happened in the passage. Standing in the middle of the most powerful kingdom in the world, like I said, under the decree of the most powerful king, Daniel did the unthinkable. Daniel resolved. He just said, I'm sorry. He bucked up. And you know, you look up the word resolved. It's very interesting in the Hebrew. It means to set or put, right? So here's what Daniel did. He just put his foot down. He said, King, you've come far enough. I put up with this. I put up with that. I mean, I had to pack my bags. You know what I mean? I had to move that big old television. You know what I'm saying? The U-Haul truck broke down halfway over. I mean, we've had a rough road, but I've had enough. I'm not eating what you're serving. Come on. You can shout me down. You can. It's okay. We can have a little church up in here. Although everything surrounding Daniel changed, the Bible says Daniel resolved. You got to hear that. We've got to hear that. Can I tell you, our families have to hear that. Our parents have to hear that. Are you hearing me today? Everything's changing around us, but you've got to make a decision as a follower of Jesus Christ. Come on, to resolve something in your life. You got to put your foot down somewhere and say, King, you've come far enough. And here's the thing you got to hear. Daniel refused to allow the world around him to change the world within him. Oh man, you'll be driving home halfway home tonight and you'll just have a moment where you'll just, that was good. I remember that line. That was, you got to refuse to allow the world around you to change the world within you because it's changing rapidly. And oh, by the way, not to mention there's so much pressure. Come on, does anybody feel the pressure from the world right now on the church? Does anybody feel it? Do you sense it? I mean, it's closing in. It's coming fast. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. I don't typically read from this version, but I love the wording. It's from the Phillips version. It says, don't let the world around you squeeze you into its mold. Don't put your foot down. The world we currently live in today is a modern day Babylon, where confusion reigns at every turn. I'm going to say some things. Hopefully you can hear them. People don't know what sex they are anymore. They don't know which bathroom to use. They don't know what identity they're going to be till they wake up the next morning. Come on, it's true. Our world kills the innocent and protects the guilty. We promote perversion and shame purity. We celebrate evil while suppressing righteousness. We live in a world with all authority but no accountability to God Himself. That's where we're living right now. That's what's going on. You want to know why? Because we've become our own gods. See, that's what's happened. I am That's what postmodernism has done to our culture today. We've become the God. We've become the determiner of morality and truth. There's been a movement. We all know that in the 18 and 1900s, you know, modernism was really, really the way that things went. Everything was based upon facts and research and science. And if you could prove it, it could be true. And modernism used science to drive a wedge, to separate, you know, a science from the church. And science was always attacking the church. We know that's the, you know, how it happened, you know. And people in the modern era, they looked at Christians and they said, it's foolish to have faith because you have no facts. And the only problem was, is science grew and research grew and evidence grew and people began to gain more information. The only problem is, as archaeologists studied, they kept finding and discovering more and more proof to prove that what the Bible says is actually true. True story. And archaeologists said, well, that story happened because we found this over here, and that story must have, because we found that. And then, this is crazy, and then scientists started getting saved one after another, because the more they researched, the more they found there's no possible way. So guess what happened? Modernism and science failed to silence Christianity and destroy it and remove it. So a new era has arisen. It's called postmodernism. And it's so funny how convenient this is. The postmodern world now rejects science. You can't trust science. Science is completely unreliable, they say. True story. Look it up. Now they say that there's no means of absolute truth. You can never walk into any situation or circumstance in our world anymore and know what the truth is before you walk into it. You decide what it is based upon what's happening in front of you in the moment. Are you hearing me? This is postmodernism. You need to understand that it's relative. Come on, somebody. Tolerance and relativism are the truths of the day. Yeah. Truth is personal and fluid. It changes based upon the circumstance. It's really situational ethics. I talked about this Sunday with our church. Situational ethics are simply this: doing whatever works for you in the moment. Yeah. Come on. Yeah. How many of y'all know, as followers of Jesus Christ, we can't live based upon situational ethics. We got to live on the Word of God. True story. It's time to stand on truth. Are you hearing me right now? And listen, more than ever before, I want you to know, more than ever before, the church has got to get resolute about some things. I'm telling you, friends, because they're coming fast and they're coming hard. The pressure's there. There's a lot of people bowing instead of standing. A lot of churches bowing instead of standing. A lot of people going silent, thinking it'll go away. It doesn't go away. It just grows. Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 says, wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction. Many are going to enter on the broad road, but small is the gate and narrow is the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Isn't that the truth? My man right there, it's the truth. Can I just say this to us? You ever want to know what's right or wrong? Whatever the majority is celebrating is always the wrong thing. Are you hearing me tonight? If they're going, isn't this awesome? We've got this new law passed, this new breakthrough. Isn't this whatever the majority celebrates? Come on, because wide is the road that leads to destruction. If they're cheering over here, you run the opposite way and just pray they don't catch up to you. Can I tell you all, the mood of the majority is always the wrong direction. Did you hear that? It's always the wrong, whatever the mood of the majority is, it's the wrong way. Turn around. Come on, somebody. So how was Daniel? You think about Daniel. Put yourself in Daniel's shoes if you could tonight. Because I don't know about you. When we look at this and we say Daniel was the man, you know, but you put yourself in his shoes and there's got to be weight. There's got to be pressure and fear and intimidation. I mean, just think for a moment how hard that had to have been for him. Oh, King Nebuchadnezzar. No. Like, no, I'm not. I mean, what did he do? You know? No. Like, or did he? I don't know how it went down, but he said no. Where did his resolve come from? I'm going to tell you where it came from, and I'm going to tell you tonight where your resolve has to come from. And I'm going to tell you this: if every believer in this room will go to this source and only follow this source and only tap into this source, you're going to be just fine. But if you separate from this, if you deviate from this, you're going to become confused and lost just like the world is around us. So you got to hear me. Where did it come from? Daniel was a man of Scripture. I know you're like, I came for that? Yes, that's what you came for. You knew it before you came, and I'm just reminding you. Because how many of y'all know the world will make you doubt things you know to be true because they're loud and they're intimidating and they're critical? Oh, come on, somebody. Well, I really don't know. I mean, you know, it's 2019. Yeah, I don't care that your kids are yelling at you and they disagree. Listen, the word is the word. Come on, somebody. Here's what I'm trying to say. You got to read your Bible in Babylon, okay? You got to read your Bible in Babylon, and we're in Babylon. The prophet said in Hosea chapter 4, verse 6, my people are destroyed for lack of what? Problem is, we don't know what the truth is, so we can't answer the lie. Your Bible's dusty, come on. The Holy Ghost game's gonna be crusty, all right? That's all I got to say. You got to, come on. While in Babylon, true story, look it up. While in Babylon, Daniel consulted Mosaic law. He was, imagine, every single day he's in Babylon and they're trying to indoctrinate him with other things, but he just kept going back and say, what did Moses teach me? What did Moses teach me? You know, I hear what you're saying and I know things are changing, but what did Moses say? Don't do this, don't do that, I'm not going to do this. And he just kept reading it every single day. Are you hearing me? He consulted the prophet Jeremiah. He was found reading from Jeremiah the prophet, and God's word is what kept Daniel clear-headed, come on, and focused in a world of confusion. It's the only thing we've got, church. All we've got is the word. That's all I've got, and that's all you've got. Come on. We must rely on the authority of the scriptures, or we are going to lose our way, my friends. I'm going to tell you why God sent his word. He didn't send it so we could have stories to read. He sent his word to be the moral and the social and the theological guide of every single believer that calls on the name of Jesus Christ. John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was what? It was God. People don't understand that. God's word not only existed from the beginning, but it is God himself. It's a lot of people right now trying to act like, well, I believe in God, but I just don't believe all of what the Bible says. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I like this scripture, but I don't like that one. Instead of carrying our cross, people are customizing the cross. You know what I'm saying? It just goes. And so what's happening... Hey, come on. What's happening is people trying to, they're trying to, you know, I've got faith in God. We're good, but I just don't buy this scripture right here. It just doesn't fit into my lifestyle or my narrative or my appetite. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't fit me. And so I'm going to buy all the other stuff, but I'm going to leave the 5% out over here. Here's the problem. What you don't understand is when you separate yourself from God's word, you separate yourself from God himself, because God is the word. They are inseparable. You can't separate yourself from one word of the book and be okay with the king. Doesn't work that way. Hebrews 13:8 says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So if God is the word, and if God never changes, then that means God's word never. Doesn't matter what changes in the culture. Come on, somebody. Doesn't matter what shows up, the next fad, the next pressure. Come on, the next letter that we are in our identity. Come on, it doesn't really matter what's coming down the road. Doesn't matter. And people, it's funny. People act like, Christians right now, they act like this is the only time in history that the word of God has been challenged or tested. Every generation, there's a new thing. Back in 100 AD, it was challenged. 200, 500, 1,000. You know what I'm saying? There was always a new thing coming. You know, polygamy. I mean, you just name stuff. There was always something culturally coming in saying, oh, this is the way we need to go. And guess what? Did God's word change back then? God's word has stood the test of time and remained the unchanging authority for the last several thousand years. Guess what, my friends? You better make sure you're on the right side of the word. And I better too. Regardless of what has changed culturally throughout time, God's word never changes. Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Everybody loves the word. If I say, oh, do y'all love the word? Oh, I love God's word. I love him. Until it corrects and rebukes and... Come on. Tells you there's things in your household you can't be. Come on, somebody. So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. You know what? God's word isn't just something you read and I read and we decide whether or not we're going to listen to it. You know, maybe. God's word is our authority. What it says, we do. 2,500 years ago when Babylon was pressing in, God's word was Daniel's authority. 1,950 years ago, come on somebody, when Rome was pressing in, God's word was the apostles' authority, was it not? 1,500 years ago when corruption was pressing in, God's word was Martin Luther's authority when he walked over to those church doors and he pounded 95 things on them that were wrong in the culture of the church because he said, I really don't care what you say, I care what God says, and what you're doing doesn't line up with what he says in his word. He stood on the word. And oh, by the way, in 2019, as tolerance, come on, and relativism are pressing in, guess what? God's word is our what? Authority. It's all we've got. It's all I've got. We don't look to culture for answers. Why are you checking the pulse of the culture? We go to God's unchanging word for truth. Right now in our culture, there are moral and social issues that are dividing this nation terribly. They're dividing the church as well. And that's the heartbreaking part. You would think to yourself, if all Christian churches, if the 2.1 billion Christians on planet Earth, if all of us were reading from the same book, at least we would agree on what is in there. But somehow we found a way to fight over what's printed that's never changed. I don't know how's that happen? How do you argue over letters that don't change and words that don't change? Come on, somebody. The etymology's the same. Come on, Pastor Tim. You know what I'm talking about. You a teacher. You know, I mean, how do we fight over that? It says what it says. It is what it is. God said it. It is. Come on. Why? Why is the church divided? Because the church started consulting the world instead of the word. Mainline denominations all over our country are now checking the pulse of the culture. We don't want to be rejected. We don't want to be criticized. I mean, last time I checked, Jesus was hammered to a cross. I mean, you know, wasn't he? The church has gone soft, you know, so we'd rather fit in than stand out. You know, we'd rather follow than lead. We'd rather make everybody happy, come on, than lead somebody to salvation. And so what we're doing is we're just... I'm trying. Thank you for helping me out over there. We're consulting the world instead of the word. I got another one for you. The church has become political instead of biblical. Yeah. I love y'all. I love you. Can I say this to you, friends? An elephant or a donkey should never carry more weight in a Christian's life than the cross of Jesus Christ. And you can shout that down right now. Christians making moral decisions based upon a political party instead of based upon the word of God, that I don't understand. His word is the authority. End of story. Listen. I've never seen a politician climb up on a cross and die for anybody before. Why in the world are we pledging our allegiance to broken human beings instead of a sinless Savior? I don't understand. So the question is not, what does the world say? The question is not, what do politics say? The question is, what does God's authoritative word say? So I'm going to touch on a few just to remind you. I know you know the word. This is a Bible-believing church with lots of knowledgeable Christians in it. But the world says that abortion is a woman's right to choose, doesn't it? That's what it says. That's the world's narrative right now. This will be challenging to some people. I said this to my church Sunday. But I can't be silent anymore, my friends. I cannot be silent. I feel the pressure, but I'm not eating from the king's table. I just want you to know I can't do it. The world says abortion is a woman's right to choose. That's the narrative. You notice they always focus on the woman. They never focus on the child. Changing language so that you don't feel the emotion of the truth. My question is, what does God's word say? God's word tells me that Jeremiah 1:5, before you were even in the womb, I knew you. People always argue over when does life start. I don't know, but I mean, I'm not a scientist. I'm not a doctor, but I can tell you this much. God's already making plans for you even enter the womb. So why is the debate over the womb? So my Bible says, Psalms 119, come on, David said, you knit me together in my mother's womb. You know, the word knit in the Hebrew means needlework and embroidery. Can you imagine? Just with me, just travel with me for a second. And I know this is maybe challenging to some, but I want you to hear me. This is my heart tonight. We have to follow Scripture. We got to follow the Word. So think about this for a moment. If that's true, if we believe Scripture is true in Psalms 119, David said, you knit me together, then that means that God, first of all, is involved in every intricate detail of the making of a human being. He's over here going, brown hair, and I'm going to give him blue eyes. And well, this one's going to dance. I'm a little dance juice over there, a little rhythm, you know what I mean? And that one's going to sing, and this one's going to cure cancer. You know what I'm saying? And as God, just track with me for a moment. As God is forming every lasting detail of a child in the mother's womb, the forceps of a doctor come in and rip the child out of the hands of an almighty God while he's creating it. How in the world can Christians be okay with that? How in the world can we justify it? Give me one passage of Scripture that says it's okay to take the life of a child. People always say it's a woman's right to choose. I got a question for you. What about a child's right to live? What about a child's right to live? Do they have any? Got another one for you. Ready for the next one? Y'all are like, it got real quiet up in here. It got real quiet today. That preacher's talking about some stuff. Yes, yes, sir, I am. Yes, ma'am, I am. If that's okay. Is it okay? Because I'm... The world says homosexuality is genetic. If it's genetic, you can't do nothing about it. I got real quiet right there. What does God's word say? What does his authoritative word written, come on, out of the mouth of God. You know, God breathed out of his mouth onto pages. You know, what does his authoritative word say on the subject? Leviticus chapter 20, verse 13 says it's detestable. That's what it says. And then to answer the argument of genetics, Romans chapter 1, verse 29 says it's not only an abomination or a sin. It says it is unnatural. They exchanged natural relations for unnatural. Everybody say unnatural. So if God, the creator of human life, calls the behavior unnatural, then guess what it is? It's not genetic. It's unnatural. I just want you to hear. This isn't my opinion, by the way. Listen, my opinion's not worth very much, but God's word is worth everything. And I want you to hear his word tonight. The world says, here's another one. Everybody ready for number three? You got this? We okay? The world says sexual identity is fluid. Just, on Monday I'm this, on Tuesday I'm that, on Wednesday I'm the other. Right? And I know it's to a degree it's comical, but it breaks my heart because those people are so broken and so lost and so hurting. They really are. And they need loved. You know, I've met some of the nicest people in the world that are confused in these areas. Wonderful people, precious people. People always act like people that are struggling in areas like this are from Mars or something. And they have like 3 ears and their face is green. You know what I'm saying? Like the reality is they're people just like you and me, but things have happened. People have stories. Come on, they were neglected. They were abused. They were wounded. Come on, they were mistreated. They were disrespected. The daddy was never there when he was supposed to be there so they could get their sexual identity in the first place. And so we got to be real careful when we speak truth to understand we're not piling on people and we're not condemning people and we're not destroying them. We need to love everybody. You hear that? All of them. Got to love them all. I don't think the church has near enough homosexuals in it. We need a bunch more. And we need to love the snot out of them and give them the truth. Amen. Both of them. Both of them. The world says, oh, I almost skipped one. The world says sexual identity is fluid. I started with that one. What does God's word say? This is real simple. Genesis 1:25-27. Male and female, he created them. End of story. That answers two things. First of all, that means when God was forming you, come on, he assigned your gender, right? Come on, somebody. And it also means because God pre-assigned the gender, you don't get to change your gender, right? We don't change it. We don't flip it. There ain't three of them. One and two. That's it. And if my Bible says it, then it's truth. I don't need to debate it. I don't need to argue about it. Because I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, and the word is my authority. So I'm going to ignore the pressure around me. I'm not going to eat from the king's table, and I'm just going to honor the Lord. Fourth and final one. The world says truth is hateful. Truth is hateful. See, that's the other narrative right now. If you speak the truth, you're hating me. You're rejecting me. You know what I'm saying? Truth is hateful. What does God's word say? John 8:32 says, the truth will set you free. That's what my Bible says. And so because the truth sets you free, you see, the church has been intimidated into silence. We don't speak anymore. We don't say anything anymore. We're over in the corner shivering, you know what I mean? Worried about, oh, I'm going to hide over here. You know, hide it under a bushel. No, I'm going to let it shine. Remember that song we used to sing? Ain't nobody singing anymore. You know what I'm saying? We're just hiding in the corner because we're worried about the pressure. See, what you don't understand is you studied the story of Daniel. You studied the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You studied the story of Daniel later on. And every single time, God delivered them when they stood on the word of God, okay? And to even take it a step further, this is the other part that we got to not miss. In every single occasion, when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were delivered out of the fiery furnace, guess what ended up happening? The king and all the people worshiped the Almighty God. See, we need to understand that standing up on truth actually saves souls instead of being silent. We think being silent is helping people. That's not helping people. You got to stand on truth. You don't go pick fights. You don't become disrespectful, but you stand on truth. Where am I at? Hebrews 4:12. For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates to the dividing of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, judges the thoughts and the attitude of the heart. The word of God is the ultimate judge in every single matter. End of story. There's absolutely no confusion in God's word regarding any moral issue that we're facing today. There's confusion all around. Confusion everywhere. But guess where there's no confusion? In the book. There's no confusion. God said it and he settled it. It's all in order in the book. You open up, it's all there printed. All the lines are parallel and perpendicular. You know what I'm saying? Nothing's crooked. Spelled correctly. No confusion in the word. The only place where there's confusion is in the lives and the hearts and in the churches and the communities of people that have deviated from the word of God. That's where all the confusion exists. That'll preach right there. God's word is settled. The question tonight is not what does God's word say. We know what it says. God's word is settled. The question is, are you settled on God's word? That's really the question. So I'll say it like this. When the culture, you ready? When the culture disagrees with what the Bible says, which side are you going to choose? That's the question. Which side are you going to choose? Which side am I going to choose? Satan not only knows the power of God's word, but he also knows its intentions for good. And because of this, throughout history, Satan has worked overtime to attack the credibility of God's word. Generation after generation, come on. Every 50 years, every 100, you always hear a new movement, a new thing historically where the enemy is trying to attack the word and destroy it. We know it's very interesting. Back in the 1700s, late 1600s and 1700s, there was a man by the name of Voltaire, and his life mission was to destroy the circulation of God's word. And he thought he was prophesying. He really it was a pathetic word, not a prophetic word. And so he And he declared 100 years from now, there will be no more Bibles in circulation. It'll just be a historical relic in some museum somewhere. That's what he said. I declare. At one point, he became so disrespectful towards the Word of God that he tied it on the back of a donkey and rode it through the city streets, dragging the Word of God on the ground just to mock it and make fun of it. It's very interesting because later on after he died, the Geneva Bible Institute moved into the house that man lived in and started printing Bibles on the printing press that he... I mean, you know. Pathetic, not prophetic. That's all I got. But here's the point. God's word is a juggernaut, friends. Listen, you either get behind it or it's going to pass you by. But it ain't changing. Come on. It ain't backing up. It ain't deviating. It is not adjusting to the culture. Come on. Every knee bows to it. End of story. Every day. The most recent attack, and I want you to hear it because it's important for you to know it. Am I okay on time? Do I need to be quiet? Am I okay on time? A few more minutes? Okay, I just don't know what the time frame is. I want to make sure I'm respectful. The most recent attack from the enemy has been to attack specific words and topics in translation. And that's what's happening recently. The new thing is we're needle picking. We're picking out specific topics, sensitive topics in the culture, and they're going to the translation and saying, well, that's not really what that word says. That's not really what it means. See, when it's translated, it can mean this or this. And you know what I'm saying? If you go to enough people, you'll find somebody that tells you what you want to hear, right? And so what's happening is people are trying to attack translations and specific words to make the meaning of Scripture mean something it isn't supposed to mean, so we can justify things that we know don't line up with the Word of God. In an attempt to edit or remove those things from the Bible in these areas. You know, the Bible tells us in Revelations 22, 18 through 19, and I know it specifically addresses Revelation itself, but I love this passage. It says that it warns us. It warns us against editing the book. It warns us against changing things in the Bible. And it tells us that if you add anything to the book of this prophecy, or if you take anything away from the book of this prophecy, all the curses in the book will be added to you. Come on, I don't know about you, but I don't want no curses. I just want blessings. So because all I want is blessings, I'm just going to line myself up with whatever the good book says. Oh, come on. I'm almost finished. Just a couple more minutes. Is this okay tonight? Is this all right? Are y'all good? Don't want to put you to sleep. I don't need a pea shooter, do I? No Peter? Okay. You know, it's very interesting because this whole movement about changing the meaning of words, the mantra I keep hearing is, did God really mean this? Did God really, is that really what he said? It sounds very similar to a snake that slithered up to Adam and Eve in the garden and said, did God really say that's how sin started in the first place? Y'all know what I'm talking about. So we got to be very aware of the devil's schemes that he's doing. The greatest misunderstanding about God's word is his intentions. John chapter 10, verse 10 says, Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Yeah. I have come, Jesus said, that you may have life and have it to the fullest. I believe biblical boundaries that I'm talking about tonight are not judgment. They're not hatred. They're love. Now, I know that there's been a lot of people misuse them. And they've delivered them in pride. They've delivered them in condemnation. They've delivered them in a condescending way. They've been self-righteous with the word. And how many of y'all know that doesn't work? That ain't helping nobody. The word should hug every single person. If you can't hug people with the Bible, then you need to hand it to somebody else and ask them to deliver the word, because I'm going to tell you, you need to love people with God's word. But the greatest way to identify the work of Satan is to follow the path of death. Remember, Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus comes to bring life. I'm going to give you some statistics and I'm done. Since Roe v. Wade in 1973, do you know there's been 60,942,033 babies that have lost their lives? Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus has come to bring what? You want to know when the enemy's working? Just follow death. Just follow the path of death. I'm telling you, it'll manifest itself. Do you know that statistically, the suicide rate for women who have an abortion is 4 times higher? My heart breaks because so many women have been lied to. They didn't know the difference. They've made mistakes in their life. I don't want any female to beat themselves up over decisions that have happened in the past, things they didn't know. We understand it happens. God wants to redeem you. Come on and lift you and restore you. But I just want you to know that if the suicide rate's 4 times higher, then that means that's another road of death. And we know that Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. If God was blessing that behavior, if he was okay with it, then the suicide rate would be half as much or a third. It's 4 times higher because it's bringing death into the life of people. Do you know the suicide? This is heartbreaking. The suicide rate among the homosexual and LGBTQ community. You think about caring about people. Man, I'm going to tell you, this breaks your heart. It's 5 times more likely that a person who struggles in one of those areas will commit suicide. Listen to this. And 92% attempt suicide at least once before the age of 25 years old. 92%. You want to know if God's in something? You want to know if the devil's behind something? Jesus always leads to life, and the devil always manifests death. I'm tired of seeing people die. And the only way they're going to turn around is if they hear the truth. We can't be silent with the truth. We got to stand on it. God is love. Everybody say, God is love. God is love. Say this with me. Say, God loves sinners. God loves sinners. Say another one with me if you could. God has called the church to love every kind of sinner. Nicely done. But I want you to know tonight that Christians cannot edit a book we didn't write and start deciding for ourselves what a sin or a sin is not. The church must stand, just like Daniel did, on God's authoritative word. Can we give the Lord some praise tonight? Because that's... So here's what I want us to do, and I just felt like, Chad, if you could just give us a little background music, a little mood music in the back, that would be a blessing. You can do it on the piano or whatever you want to do. I just thought for the next few moments, this is the picture that I got for us, and I know that some people come from this church, and there's probably some people from other churches, and there's some people from our church that you came over to hang out, and what an honor to have everybody here tonight. I just thought this would be a good thing for us to do, because we can talk about things, but we need to do something with what we heard. We need to do something with what we talked about. So I thought it would be awesome. I'm going to pray, and if we could, I'd love for us to get into circles of maybe 3, 4, 5, 6 people. I think less than 3 isn't really a circle. You know what I mean? It's just 2 people hanging out. You know what I'm saying? So I'd like us to get in at least circles of 3, 4, 5, 6. I have one rule. Nobody is alone tonight. Nobody's alone. Nobody's alone. Nobody. So if you see somebody around you that's all by themselves and they don't have a friend, say, come hang out in my circle. You're in the circle of trust, all right? I want us to get into circles. And I'm going to ask us to pray for 3 things. And here's what I want us to pray for tonight. I'm going to ask us to pray for the church in America. Because I want you to know something, friends. Things are changing and deception is all around. I want us to pray for the church. I'm going to ask us to pray for our families all over the country, that God's word would bring freedom and life. And I'm going to ask us to pray for our children, because our kids go to school every single day. And my friends, they're being indoctrinated in Babylon by a lot of things that are not true. We need their minds and their hearts to be protected. Could we just intercede for a few minutes together? You can stand in the aisle, stand in wherever you want to go to get together in a circle. But if we could just gather in groups and pray for a few moments, and then we'll close in prayer in just a couple of minutes.
Thank you. Mercy.
close it up. Close it up. Okay. Amen. I want to thank y'all. Some people are still praying and we'll... Yes. Okay. Yes. If you're praying, just continue to pray. Two things I want to make you aware of before you dismiss tonight. As I was praying, walking up here in the front, the Lord reminded me of something. I want to remind everybody of this. That in every circumstance in the book of Daniel, notice the fight always came to them. They never went and picked a fight. And so I think it's critically important that we know as Christians in this time that we're wise as serpents and harmless as doves. We don't go pick fights. When the fight comes to you, you stand, right? But we don't go pick them. We don't go cause problems. We don't walk into situations and agitate situations. We stand on truth, amen? And when the fight comes to us, we do that. The second thing I want to tell you, I just felt like the Lord told me to make sure I said that. And then the second and last thing is we just want to invite everybody back tomorrow night. A good, very good friend of mine, longtime friend of mine. We were youth pastors together, did tons of events together for years. And we've been on missions trips together. Pastor Adam Donnell is going to be here speaking tomorrow night. And their worship team's going to be here as well. So we'd love to have you come back tomorrow night. God bless you all. Thank you. Come on, let's give the Lord one more round of praise. And thank everybody for hosting us, Bishop and Pastor. And God bless you all. Hug a few people on the way out tonight and have a beautiful ride home. Thank you so much.
Everyone, as folks are still coming in from the outside and taking their seats, we'd like to just first of all recognize the one who made this all possible. A holy and awesome, incredible, indescribable God. Father, we just give you praise, we give you glory, we give you honor, we bless the name of your Son, Jesus. We praise the Lord for his Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We just want to take a moment and enter in to this evening with prayer. If you'll bow your heads. Father God, we just thank you and we praise you for who you are. You are wonderful. You are counselor. You are deliverer. You are savior. You are friend. You are husband. You are amazing. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, we just plead the blood of the Lamb over this room, over the roof, the walls, the floors, over each and every one of us, our spirits, souls, and bodies. And God, as we come before you, we recognize that we fall short. We fall short in our thought life, in our words, in our deeds sometimes. And we ask right now in Jesus' name, forgive us, God, for falling short of that high calling that is in Christ Jesus. But Lord, we thank you and we praise you that we can have confidence that when we confess our sins, you are faithful to forgive us. So Lord, we can come into your throne room boldly. As we do so tonight, God, I ask, Lord, that you come into this place, that you fill this house, Lord, with your presence, that you anoint every singer, every speaker, God, with your word, with your spirit, God, so that a holiness would pour forth, Lord, Father, that it would fill this place and that each and every one of us would walk out changed so that we can be changers. Amen. Yes, make us more like you, God. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. And now, if you would take your seats, we're going to get this service started. I'd like to invite Pastor Charlie Davis who's also being elected to the office of bishop. Praise God. Congratulations. Come on up, and if you can get us started, sir.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Praise the Lord. Somebody say praise the Lord. We want to welcome you tonight to the IFM conference tonight, and we'll be having service tonight as well as tomorrow night and Friday evening. Definitely come back on Friday night if you can. That will be the time of the ordination of three pastors, three bishop-elects moving into the office of bishop, and we just really would appreciate the support and the love and your prayers. So we want to welcome you. We want to ask that you enjoy yourself with us tonight. We give honor to our bishop, our presiding bishop, Bishop Mel Griffin, in the absence of his wife, Minister Donna, as well as the angel of this house, Pastor Tim and Lady Beth. Amen. We honor them, love them. And most of all, we're excited to hear from your pastor, James Dewhurst, in Real Church. Excited for you being here tonight. So when you're ready, All right, I'm going to turn it back over to Courtney, or you want me to go ahead and give it to him? Praise and worship. All right, stand to your feet then. If we're going to do praise and worship, we're going to stand to our feet.
Amen.
And we're going to enter in. Bless
Amen.
You.
Amen. Good evening, good evening. How many of y'all are doing good tonight? If you're good, say, I'm good.
I'm good.
If you're ready, say, I'm ready.
I'm ready.
Listen, the Bible says in Psalms 150, verse 1 through 6, praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. That's where we're at tonight. So this is a good place to do it. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him for His acts of power. Praise Him for His surpassing greatness. Praise Him for the sound of trumpets. Praise Him with the harp and lyre. Praise Him with the timbrel and dancing. Praise Him with strings and with pipes. Praise Him, come on somebody, with a clash of cymbals. You can give me some if you want to. That's okay. There we go. Praise Him with resounding cymbals. And then it says, let everything... Somebody out there say, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Listen, worship is an extravagant public expression to an almighty and worthy God. Let's get our praise on tonight. I know some of you may not know all of these songs, but we praise the same Savior. So as you sing them, get to know them, let's lift our hands, let's lift our voices, and let's give God all that we've got tonight in Jesus' name. Here we go. Come on, put your hands together, say
wide open spaces, graces waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted.
Come on, say,
graces waiting.
Come on,
where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom.
Come on, say,
come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom. Let there be freedom.
Come on, church, say.
Spaces, graces waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted.
Come on, say,
grace is waiting. Oh, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom.
Yes.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom.
Come on.
Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit.
You deny God.
Oh,
come on, chains will fall. Let's declare it. Say,
chains will fall. Prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Come on, say those words.
Lives made whole. Hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Come on,
chains will fall. Prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole.
Come on. God wants to loosen us up tonight a little bit. Come on. Come on. Get a little stretch out. Say,
dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting. Oh, dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting. Oh, dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting.
Next song, I want to encourage y'all tonight to raise a hallelujah with us in the place tonight. Amen. Hallelujah. And I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. Sing it out. And I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. Oh, I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is melody. comes to fight for me. Oh, and I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Inside of you tonight, say, with everything inside of me, oh, I raise a hallelujah, and I will watch, and I will watch the darkness flee, yeah, yeah, and I raise a hallelujah, in the middle of the mystery, I don't know the answers, but I know the answer. I raise a hallelujah. Fear's lost its hold on me, yeah. And I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. If you would deny, sing a little louder. Come on, help me out. Say,
sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Come on, church, lift it up. Say, sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
I'll sing a little.
Jesus. Mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being moved. God, we believe. Yes, we can see. Wonders are still what you do.
Let's just prophesy in Isaiah.
Bodies are still being raised. Giants are still being slain. God, we believe. Yes, we can see it. Wonders are still what you do. 'Cause we are here for you. Come and do what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. Set our hearts on you. Come and do what you do. 'Cause we need a move.
Come on, sing that out. Just cry out. Say, God, we need a move.
We need a move, yeah. We need a move, oh
God.
We need a move.
Come on, bodies are still being raised. We declare it tonight. Say,
bodies are still being raised. Giants are still being slain. Coming in this.
healing is coming in this room. Miracles happen when you move. Heaven is coming, oh. Miracles happen when you move. Healing is coming in this room, oh. Miracles happen when you move. Heaven is coming. One more time, we sing it. Oh, miracles happen.
Come on, say the name. Come on, thank Him. Say the name. Jesus, we want You. Jesus, we need You more and more.
Ground tonight.
Oh,
oh, let this be holy ground, Jesus.
Come on, declare that with us.
Everything, lives healed, hope it's found here and now. Jesus, you change everything. Come on,
chains fall, fear.
Just say the name. Come on, sing it out, shout it out, whatever you got to do. Father, we thank you for your presence and your power and your life. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Father, we just honor your presence tonight. How to do it. This is how I find my battle. And this is how I find my battles. By lifting his name and praising him. Come on, sing it with me. Just say it together. Say, and this is how I find my battle. No, no, no. This is how I find my battle. This is how I fight my battles. Yeah. This is how I fight my battles. Yes, God, it may look, but we know the truth. Sing it with me, say. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Oh. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded. I wish we had a couple worshipers here tonight that would sing with me, say. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Oh, it may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Come on. This is how I fight my battles. Yeah. Oh, come on, lift his name, say. This is how I fight my battles. Yeah. Oh, this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battle. It may look, yeah. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded. Come on, tell heaven you know it. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded. Yeah. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. 'Cause this is
is how I fight my battles. Yeah. Oh, this is how I fight my battles. Oh, forever, Lord, yeah. This is how I fight my battles. Oh, 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 oh. This is how I fight my battles. Yeah, come on, sing it with me. Everything you got, one more time, say. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. Yeah. Oh, this is how I fight my battles. Yeah. Oh, this is how I fight my battles. Yeah, yeah. Sing it with me one last time. It may look like I'm surrounded. Come on, church, sing it to your Savior. Like I'm surrounded, but I'm no. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm no. Come on, one more time, sing it. It may look, oh. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm
surrounded by you.
Forever and always. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm
surrounded by you.
Mm-hmm. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Oh, it may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battle. Oh, come on, give him praise. This is how I fight my battle. See, you worship and he fights for you. That's what we forget. This is how I fight. Oh. Mm. This is how I fight my battle. Yeah. Father, we love your spirit. Oh.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Oh, my goodness. The presence of the Lord is in this place. The presence of the Lord is in this place. Amen. Testing? Okay, we're good, I think. It is a great privilege and honor to once again have the Interdenominational Fellowship Ministries Conference here at Trinity at the Eastern Gate. So pleased with what all the work that Bishop Mel and his team have put together and for this week of services, it's awesome. I love the theme. The time is now. The time is now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to receive an offering tonight, and so I'm going to pray, and we'll receive the offering, and then I'm turning it back over to our presider, and Courtney, she's going to take care of that. Let's pray. Lord, in your presence now, the time is now. And so, Lord, we give to you as an act of worship. Our giving, Lord, is worshiping you. Lord, worship is not one way, it's two ways. And so, Lord, we worship you. We adore you. And Lord, tonight we honor you with these offerings that we have brought into your presence. Lord, would they bring delight to your heart? Would you be pleased with our offering tonight? for the advancement of your kingdom, furtherance of the gospel of Jesus Christ. These things we pray, Father, tonight. Bless this offering. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
If you can just stand to your feet and everybody come to these middle aisles and come right around here, you can just go right around. We'll start with the rear and just come on forward. Praise God, praise God. Just start with the rear, yep. Just come on down this middle aisle and walk around. Praise the Lord. Maybe musician, can you give me a little something, some music? Can you give me a little instrumental, a little something right now? Can you give me a little? Oh, praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank. Just come on down. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There we go. There we go. We're going to turn this over to the hands of Minister Courtney.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Isn't it just such a beautiful thing? I don't know how many different fellowships we have in this house tonight, but I praise God that his body can come together as one and give praise and glory to the head, to the King of Kings, to Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. So bless you all. Thank you for coming out tonight. We are so happy to have real worship with real church in the house tonight. And thank you so much to you and your team. What a wonderful presence you've ushered in. Help us usher in tonight, and we thank you for that. And tonight we are pleased to have Pastor James Dewhurst and his wife Tiffany from Real Church with us here at the IFM Fall Conference. Pastor James and Tiffany have led youth ministries for most of their careers, starting here in Ohio and then in Georgia. They've also produced a couple of albums, I believe, praise God, and spoken at many conferences throughout their years of service. They also have raised two children, Malachi and Melina, before returning to Ohio and starting Real Church in 2013. In just a few short years, Real Church in Pataskala has grown from an idea and a call and a whisper from the Lord to more than 400 attendees across two different services each Sunday. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Reaching the community for Jesus. Pastor James began with an associate degree in biblical theology. He received his bachelor's in Christian counseling, and just in the last, month, maybe, or so, he attained his master's in practical theology. So not only does he have experience, but he has some good education. God has truly blessed Pastor James. He has an energetic approach to proclaiming the gospel, and he shows and tells how to apply it in our everyday lives. Lord, let's just all give it up for Pastor James. Come on up. Thank you so much. God bless you.
You introduced me better than I'm going to preach. What am I supposed to do? I told her, I said, she introduced me better than I might preach. I don't know what to do with all that. That was rather impressive. Thank you, Courtney. I'd show up and hear me preach too if I was actually that awesome. So you buttered me up a little bit. Thank you so much. Greatly appreciate the privilege and honor of being here tonight. And I'm gonna make sure I don't lose my notes there. I'm gonna change a couple things. That's gonna fall off. So let's fix that. Good to see you all. Who's excited to be in the house of the Lord? We got any? excited Christians to be here. Well, listen, it is an honor and a privilege to be here tonight. And I'll tell you, I made one person a little disappointed, and I have to be honest with you. That's my daughter. She is a soccer player, among other things, and I'm her coach. And I had to skip coaching tonight and miss her game. And so I was getting text messages a little bit earlier. But if you could throw up that picture of our family. Do you have that or no? It probably is. There we go. Yeah, so this is, I just want to introduce them. So my wife didn't make it because she's on the sidelines of the soccer field. All the way on the right is my wife. We celebrate 21 years tomorrow. All right, that's pretty awesome. And then that's me, and then that's my 12-year-old amazing daughter, Melina, who is, I'm just so proud of her. I love her to pieces, and she's a singer and a worshiper. She's learned to play piano and a bunch of cool stuff, so we love that. And then we don't know what happened to the guy there. He passed all of us up. We were feeding him something, the hormones and the food. I don't know what's going on, but that's my eldest son, Malachi, and he is, come on, God's messenger, Malachi. We got to get some of that right there, and he just... signed a basketball scholarship, and he's going to play basketball and go to school at Ohio Christian University down in Circleville. And so, yeah. So I just wanted to introduce you to my family so you knew who we were. And what an honor and a privilege. Thank you, Bishop, for having me and inviting me. It's a privilege to be here. By the way, is he not one of the nicest, coolest guys to hang around on the planet? I mean, just cool as a cucumber, man. Yeah, I see y'all. And thank you, Pastor Tim, and your wife as well for hosting this and having us here tonight. It's an honor and a privilege to be here. So we're going to jump in, and I'm going to preach a word. We have been in a series as a church for the past 3 weeks, and we're going to finish it up Sunday. And I was wrestling through, what do I preach and what do I share? And I felt like the Lord laid on my heart to share one of the messages that I've recently shared at our church because of the topic and because of what it's addressing. The time or the title of your conference, the theme was "The Time Is Now," and I've titled the message tonight, "It's Time to Stand on Truth." It's the time is now. It's time to stand on truth, and so we're going to get into that. Before we do, I always try to do something funny at our church, and I have to be me, so I'm going to try to share a little story with you. There was a pastor, he was 10 minutes into his Sunday sermon on a Sunday morning, and he looked up and he noticed his young son sitting in the balcony with a pea shooter. And he was leaning over the balcony, and one after another, he was popping people right in the back of the head, just, you know, just nailing them, bam, one after another. Pastor started getting frustrated. I mean, he's trying to preach, and his son's losing his mind up there, you know, and it's supposed to be an example, you know, pastor kids, all that stuff, you know the stigma. And right as the pastor, I mean, he reaches his height of frustration. He reaches this fuming point, and he's getting prepared to deliver a public rebuke to his son in front of the entire congregation, which he doesn't want to do, but he's got to. Right at the moment where he's getting ready to speak, his 7-year-old son hollers out, "Hey, Dad, you keep preaching, and I'll keep them all awake." So here's the deal, okay? I'm going to do my best not to need a pea shooter tonight, okay? I'm going to do my best. But listen, you can come on. But y'all got to help me out, okay? So if I'm going to preach good, you got to talk good. Is that okay? And by the way, if you can't tell, I got a little soul up in me. Is it okay if I share the soul tonight? Can I give y'all a little soul up in here? See, people told me my whole life, I'm light on the outside, but I'm dark on the inside. And so I'm going to have a little church with my friends. So let's bow our heads for the word of opening prayer. Father, we thank you for your goodness and grace. We ask that your spirit would be here. And Lord, as I speak forth your word, God, I pray that you'd use me as a vessel. Cleanse my heart and mind. Help me, Father, to have nothing in my heart or mind, God, that would keep you from moving freely in this room. God, I pray that you'd speak, that you'd deliver, Father, that you'd reveal, God, that you'd empower, God, that you'd encourage, God, that you'd set free, God, that you'd motivate in the mighty name of Jesus. And all of God's people said,
amen.
Okay, you're getting good. You're getting good. Well, I'd like to start tonight by talking to us about standing on truth in a changing culture. How many of y'all realize the culture is changing, and it's changing real fast? I mean, super, super fast. I'm going to talk to you a little bit for a few minutes about Daniel. I'll give you a little backstory about Daniel and the the time of Daniel, Babylon was much like the United States of America is today. I'm going to give you a little parallel if I could. It was not only the most powerful and successful empire in the world at the time, this Babylon, but it also became the cultural center of the entire world. People came from everywhere because it was strategically located between the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers, and it became this trade port, this diverse trade route where ships would come and go, and people from all cultures and walks of life would show up. And under the 43-year reign of the king Nebuchadnezzar, the empire expanded by force. They were strong, and they just started taking land from people, kicking butt and taking names. We'll just say it like that. That's what they were doing. And guess what? Jerusalem was in their path. And they conquered Jerusalem. And the Hebrew people were taken captive under King Nebuchadnezzar. All of Judah was forced to move from the land and the city and the culture that they knew. And they had to transplant themselves. Pack your bags. You're moving, whether you want to or not. And they had to move over to Babylon. Along with plundering the city and the Jewish people, the Jewish temple itself was plundered. They took things out of the temple, and King Nebuchadnezzar's soldiers and people transported articles of worship that were meant for God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob only. Those articles were transferred over, and they were put into the Babylonian temple, right, where there were many gods and many false things. It became an article of worship for many instead of the article for the one and only true God, and that's what had happened on that day. Nebuchadnezzar took four of Jerusalem's finest young men. He said, you know what we're going to do? We're going to make our kingdom stronger. So we're going to look through all of the Hebrews, and we're going to decide which ones are the smartest and the sharpest. And we're going to take them, and we're going to train them in our ways, and we're going to put them in our leadership and government so that we can continue to be strong and rule the world. So four of these Hebrews went into a three-year Babylonian school. They went into this university, as it were, and they were trained to serve in the Babylonian kingdom. They were taught new languages. They were taught a new religion. They were taught new cultural practices, and they were even given a new diet. You're going to eat from the king's table. You're not going to eat what everybody else eats. You're going to eat from the king's table. It's interesting. Very interesting. Sounds good, but maybe it isn't. It was in the beginning days of this Babylonian indoctrination when a Hebrew named Daniel rose up. I'm going to read to you the story. And forgive me for reading lots of verses, but I'm preaching from the Bible, so I'm going to give a lot of scripture tonight. I don't know about you, but you didn't come for my opinion. You came for the word. And so Daniel chapter 1 verse 1 says, in the third year of the reign of King Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came in to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the articles from the temple of God. These he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia and put in the treasure house of his God. And then the king ordered Ashpenaz, chief of the court officials, to bring into the king's service some of the Israelites from the royal family and nobility, young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude for every kind of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. Sounds like I'm describing some people in the room tonight. You can shout me down. I knew I'd have somebody claim that. Okay, that's me, Pastor. That's me. Ha. He was to teach them the language and the literature of the Babylonians. The king assigned them a daily amount of food and wine from the king's table. And they were to be trained for 3 years. And after that, they were to enter the king's service. Among those who were chosen were some from Judah: Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Or you know them as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The chief official gave them new names. Come on, y'all need to watch out for people that try to rename you. We'll talk about that in a moment, because the world will try to rename you. You need to know that. To Daniel, the name Belshazzar, to Hananiah, Shadrach, to Mishael, Meshach, and to Azariah, Abednego. But Daniel resolved. Everybody say, but Daniel resolved. Don't forget that line. But Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and the wine, and he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself this way. Now God had caused the official to show favor and compassion to Daniel, but the official told Daniel, I'm afraid, because here's what I'm worried about. I'll not let you have to eat the king's food, but if you come in looking frail and weak and all messed up, eyes sunken in, you know, having that bedhead, you walk in like that, listen, the king's going to take my life because you're not eating what you're supposed to be eating. It's a true story. So he said, I'm afraid of the Lord my king. Why should he see you looking worse than all the other young men your age? The king would have my head because of you. And then Daniel said to the guard whom the chief official had appointed over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, please do me a favor. Just test your servant for 10 days. give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Y'all know the Daniel fast. This is where it started. It got birthed right here because somebody resolved, okay? You just got to resolve and things happen. And verse 13, then compare our appearance with that of all the other young men in the kingdom who eat from the royal food. You compare our appearance to theirs and treat your servants in accordance to what you see. So he agreed to this, and he tested them for 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, they looked healthier and better nourished than any of the other young men who ate the royal food. So the guard took away their choice food and wine that they were to drink and gave them vegetables instead. To these four young men, God gave knowledge and understanding of all kinds of literature and learning. And Daniel could understand visions and dreams of all kinds. At the end of the time set by the king to bring them into his service, the chief official presented them to Nebuchadnezzar. And the king talked with them. Oh, here's the test. Come on. And he found none equal. Come on, somebody, to Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. So they entered the king's service. Can I tell you, God always blesses people who stand on their convictions. Can I just tell you right now, he protects them. He makes them healthy. He looks after them. Come on. He covers them on the rear side. Come on, somebody, you hear me tonight? And much like what is happening in our world today, can I tell you, everything changed around Daniel, didn't it? Everything changed around him. I'm going to tell you about what changed. In 605 BC, after Daniel was taken captive in his new homeland, the values all around him immediately changed. The value system changed. The decrees of God that Daniel had held so sacred all of his life were now in this new land treated as common. I mean, we don't really care what you do over in Jerusalem. You know, we don't, come on, you people of Judah, we really don't care what you do and how you serve. Let me tell you what we do over here. You're going to do what we do. And in this new Babylonian religious melting pot, all these religions and beliefs were just kind of mixed all together, all muddied up. Y'all know that's what's happening in our world today. People are trying to say things like, we all worship the same God, just with a different name. How many of y'all know that's not true? Amen? It's not true. It's not true. It's changing, but it's not true. Daniel's political, cultural, and social climate changed as well, as Nebuchadnezzar, a king who had no accountability to God whatsoever, created an environment of idolatry and paganism. Wow. Daniel's name was changed along with three of his Hebrew friends for the purpose. You want to know why they changed their names? For the purpose of stripping them of their Hebrew identity. Oh, come on. To rename them the property of Babylon. I tell you, I want you to know, church, the world is trying to rename Christians. They're trying to call them hateful. You know, they're trying to say they're this, they're that, they're the other. You know, you stand on truth and they try to throw mud at you. They try to call you by a different name. Don't let anybody change your name. Daniel's education changed as he was forced into a university to learn a new language, a new worldview that was contrary to that of the scriptures. Daniel's diet also changed. As he was commanded to eat food from the king's table, the problem was, you said, why would you stand up and have an issue with that? I mean, the king's food's got to be good, right? It's got to taste good. It probably tastes good. But the problem was, the king's food was sacrificed to idols before it was served. You hear that? See, Daniel said, I'm sorry, but I serve the one true God. I can't eat food from your table. You know what I'm saying? I can't do it. And see, that's why he stood up. Y'all understand, the world is also trying to feed us things that we can't eat. You know what I'm saying? Because he's got meat to eat that we know not of. And I don't need to eat your meat. According to Hebrew law, it was unclean for Daniel to partake. And he said, I'm sorry, I can't do it. Imagine just for a moment. I mean, just think for a moment. This Daniel standing up to the most powerful king in the most powerful kingdom on the planet. And he said, no. I mean, just put yourself in, just for a moment. No, I'm sorry. I'm not going to do that. Powerful, powerful. Can I just say this to you? You can't live on the world's diet and expect to bear heaven's fruit. Can I just say that tonight? We can't be eating the things of the world and expect to bear heavenly fruit. It doesn't work that way. We've got to eat, come on, the right kind of stuff. Something incredible happened in the passage. Standing in the middle of the most powerful kingdom in the world, like I said, under the decree of the most powerful king, Daniel did the unthinkable. Daniel resolved. He just said, I'm sorry. He bucked up. And you know, you look up the word resolved. It's very interesting in the Hebrew. It means to set or put, right? So here's what Daniel did. He just put his foot down. He said, King, you've come far enough. I put up with this. I put up with that. I mean, I had to pack my bags. You know what I mean? I had to move that big old television. You know what I'm saying? The U-Haul truck broke down halfway over. I mean, we've had a rough road. but I've had enough. I'm not eating what you're serving. Come on, you can shout me down. You can. It's okay. We can have a little church up in here. Although everything surrounding Daniel changed, the Bible says Daniel resolved. You got to hear that. We've got to hear that. Can I tell you, our families have to hear that. Our parents have to hear that. Are you hearing me today? Everything's changing around us, but you've got to make a decision as a follower of Jesus Christ. Come on. To resolve something in your life. You've got to put your foot down somewhere and say, King, you've come far enough. And here's the thing you got to hear. Daniel refused to allow the world around him to change the world within him. Oh, man. You'll be driving home halfway home tonight and you'll just have a moment where you'll just, that was good. I remember that line. That was, you got to refuse to allow the world around you to change the world within you because it's changing rapidly. And oh, by the way, not to mention, there's so much pressure. Come on, does anybody feel the pressure from the world right now on the church? Does anybody feel it? Do you sense it? I mean, it's closing in, it's coming fast. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. I don't typically read from this version, but I love the wording. It's from the Phillips version. It says, don't let the world around you squeeze you into its mold. Don't put your foot down. The world we currently live in today is a modern day Babylon, where confusion reigns at every turn. I'm going to say some things. Hopefully you can hear them. People don't know what sex they are anymore. They don't know which bathroom to use. They don't know what identity they're going to be till they wake up the next morning. Come on, it's true. Our world kills the innocent and protects the guilty. We promote perversion and shame purity. We celebrate evil while suppressing righteousness. We live in a world with all authority but no accountability to God Himself. That's where we're living right now. That's what's going on. You want to know why? Because we've become our own gods. See, that's what's happened. I am. That's what postmodernism has done to our culture today. We've become the God. We've become the determiner of morality and truth. There's been a movement. We all know that in the 1800s and 1900s, you know, modernism was really, really the way that things went. Everything was based upon facts and research and science. And if you could prove it, it could be true. And modernism used science to drive a wedge, to separate, you know, a science from the church. And science was always attacking the church. We know that's, how it happened, you know, and people in the modern era, they looked at Christians and they said, it's foolish to have faith because you have no facts. And the only problem was, is science grew and research grew and evidence grew and people began to gain more information. The only problem is, as archaeologists studied, they kept finding and discovering more and more proof to prove that what the Bible says is actually true. True story. And archaeologists said, well, that story happened because we found this over here, and that story must have, because we found that. And then, this is crazy, and then scientists started getting saved one after another because the more they researched, the more they found there's no possible way. So guess what happened? Modernism and science failed to silence Christianity and destroy it and remove it. So a new era has arisen. It's called postmodernism. And it's so funny how convenient this is. The postmodern world now rejects science. You can't trust science. Science is completely unreliable, they say. True story. Look it up. Now they say that there's no means of absolute truth. You can never walk into any situation or circumstance in our world anymore and know what the truth is before you walk into it. You decide what it is based upon what's happening in front of you in the moment. Are you hearing me? This is postmodernism. You need to understand that it's relative. Come on, somebody. Tolerance and relativism are the truths of the day. Truth is personal and fluid. It changes based upon the circumstance. It's really situational ethics. I talked about this Sunday with our church. Situational ethics are simply this: doing whatever works for you in the moment. Yeah. Come on. Yeah. How many of y'all know, as followers of Jesus Christ, we can't live based upon situational ethics. We got to live on the Word of God. True story. It's time to stand on truth. Are you hearing me right now? And listen, more than ever before, I want you to know, more than ever before, the church has got to get resolute about some things. I'm telling you, friends, because they're coming fast and they're coming hard. The pressure's there. There's a lot of people bowing instead of standing. A lot of churches bowing instead of standing. A lot of people going silent, thinking it'll go away. It doesn't go away, it just grows. Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 says, "Wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction. Many are going to enter on the broad road, but small is the gate and narrow is the road that leads to life, and only a few find it." Isn't that the truth? My man right there, it's the truth. Can I just say this to us? If you ever want to know what's right or wrong, whatever the majority is celebrating is always the wrong thing. Are you hearing me tonight? If they're going, "Isn't this awesome? We've got this new law passed, this new breakthrough. Isn't this..." Whatever the majority celebrates, come on, because wide is the road that leads to destruction. If they're cheering over here, you run the opposite way and just pray they don't catch up to you. Can I tell you all, the mood of the majority is always the wrong direction. Did you hear that? It's always the wrong, whatever the mood of the majority is, it's the wrong way. Turn around, come on somebody. So how was Daniel? You think about Daniel. Put yourself in Daniel's shoes if you could tonight. Because I don't know about you. When we look at this, we say Daniel was the man, you know, but you put yourself in his shoes and there's got to be weight. There's got to be pressure and fear and intimidation. I mean, just think for a moment how hard that had to have been for him. Oh, King Nebuchadnezzar. No, like, no, I'm not. I mean, what did he do, you know? No, like, or did he? I don't know how it went down, but he said no. Where did his resolve come from? I'm going to tell you where it came from, and I'm going to tell you tonight where your resolve has to come from. And I'm going to tell you this, if every believer in this room will go to this source and only follow this source and only tap into this source, you're going to be just fine. But if you separate from this, if you deviate from this, you're going to become confused and lost just like the world is around us. So you got to hear me. Where did it come from? Daniel was a man of Scripture. I know you're like, "I came for that." Yes, that's what you came for. You knew it before you came, and I'm just reminding you. Because how many of y'all know the world will make you doubt things you know to be true because they're loud and they're intimidating and they're critical. Oh, come on, somebody. "Well, I really don't know. I mean, you know, it's 2019. Yeah, I don't care that your kids are yelling at you and they disagree. Listen, the word is the word. Come on, somebody. Here's what I'm trying to say. You got to read your Bible in Babylon, okay? You got to read your Bible in Babylon, and we're in Babylon. The prophet said in Hosea chapter 4, verse 6, "My people are destroyed for lack of what?" Problem is, we don't know what the truth is, so we can't answer the lie. Your Bible's dusty, come on. The Holy Ghost game's going to be crusty, all right? That's all I got to say. You got to, come on. While in Babylon, true story, look it up. While in Babylon, Daniel consulted Mosaic law. Can you imagine, every single day he's in Babylon and they're trying to indoctrinate him with other things, but he just kept going back and say, "What did Moses teach me? What did Moses teach me? You know, I hear what you're saying and I know things are changing, but what did Moses say? Don't do this, don't do that. I'm not going to do..." And he just kept reading it every single day. Are you hearing me? He consulted the prophet Jeremiah. He was found reading from Jeremiah the prophet, and God's word is what kept Daniel clear-headed, come on, and focused in a world of confusion. It's the only thing we've got, church. All we've got is the word. That's all I've got, and that's all you've got. Come on. We must rely on the authority of the Scriptures, or we are going to lose our way, my friends. I'm going to tell you why God sent his word. He didn't send it so we could have stories to read. He sent his word to be the moral and the social and the theological guide of every single believer that calls on the name of Jesus Christ. John 1:1 says, "In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was what?" It was God. People don't understand that. God's word not only existed from the beginning, but it is God himself. It's a lot of people right now trying to act like, "Well, I believe in God, but I just don't believe all of what the Bible says." Y'all know what I'm talking about. I like this scripture, but I don't like that one. instead of carrying our cross, people are customizing the cross. You know what I'm saying? It just goes. And so what's happening? Hey, come on. What's happening is people trying to, they're trying to, you know, I've got faith in God. We're good, but I just don't buy this scripture right here. It just doesn't fit into my lifestyle or my narrative or my appetite. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't fit me. And so I'm going to buy all the other stuff, but I'm going to leave the 5% out over here. Here's the problem. What you don't understand is when you separate yourself from God's word, you separate yourself from God himself, because God is the word. They are inseparable. You can't separate yourself from one word of the book and be okay with the king. Doesn't work that way. Hebrews 13:8 says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So if God is the word, and if God never changes, then that means God's word never. Doesn't matter what changes in the culture. Come on, somebody. Doesn't matter what shows up, the next fad, the next pressure. Come on, the next letter that we are in our identity. Come on, it doesn't really matter what's coming down the road. Doesn't matter. And people, it's funny. People act like, Christians right now, they act like this is the only time in history that the word of God has been challenged or tested. Every generation, there's a new thing. Back in 100 AD, it was challenged. 200, 500, 1,000. You know what I'm saying? There was always a new thing coming. You know, polygamy. I mean, you just name stuff. There was always something culturally coming in saying, oh, this is the way we need to go. And guess what? Did God's word change back then? God's word has stood the test of time and remained the unchanging authority for the last several thousand years. Guess what, my friends? You better make sure you're on the right side of the word. And I better too. Regardless of what has changed culturally throughout time, God's word never changes. Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Everybody loves the word. If I say, oh, do y'all love the word? Oh, I love God's word. I love him. Until it corrects and rebukes and... Come on. Tells you there's things in your household you can't be. Come on, somebody. So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. You know what? God's word isn't just something you read and I read and we decide whether or not we're going to listen to it. You know, I maybe. God's word is our authority. What it says, we do. 2,500 years ago when Babylon was pressing in, God's word was Daniel's authority. 1,950 years ago, come on somebody, when Rome was pressing in, God's word was the apostles' authority, was it not? 1,500 years ago, when corruption was pressing in, God's word was Martin Luther's authority when he walked over to those church doors and he pounded 95 things on them that were wrong in the culture of the church, because he said, I really don't care what you say, I care what God says, and what you're doing doesn't line up with what he says in his word. He stood on the word. And oh, by the way, in 2019, as tolerance, come on, and relativism are pressing in, guess what? God's word is our what? Authority. It's all we've got. It's all I've got. We don't look to culture for answers. Why are you checking the pulse of the culture? We go to God's unchanging word for truth. Right now in our culture, there are moral and social issues that are dividing this nation terribly. They're dividing the church as well. And that's the heartbreaking part. You would think to yourself, if all Christian churches, if the 2.1 billion Christians on planet Earth, if all of us were reading from the same book, at least we would agree on what is in there. But somehow we found a way to fight over what's printed that's never changed. I don't know how's that happen? How do you argue over letters that don't change and words that don't change? Come on, somebody. The etymology's the same. Come on, Pastor Tim, you know what I'm talking about. You a teacher, you know. I mean, how do we fight over that? It says what it says. It is what it is. God said it. It is. Come on. Why? Why is the church divided? Because the church started consulting the world instead of the word. Mainline denominations all over our country are now checking the pulse of the culture. We don't want to be rejected. We don't want to be criticized. I mean, last time I checked, Jesus was hammered to a cross. I mean, you know, wasn't he? The church has gone soft, you know, so we'd rather fit in than stand out. You know, we'd rather follow than lead. We'd rather make everybody happy, come on, than lead somebody to salvation. And so what we're doing is we're just... I'm trying. Thank you for helping me out over there. We're consulting the world instead of the word. I got another one for you. The church has become political instead of biblical. Yeah. I love y'all. I love you. Can I say this to you, friends? An elephant or a donkey should never carry more weight in a Christian's life than the cross of Jesus Christ. And you can shout that down right now. Christians making moral decisions based upon a political party instead of based upon the word of God, that I don't understand. His word is the authority. End of story. Listen. I've never seen a politician climb up on a cross and die for anybody before. Why in the world are we pledging our allegiance to broken human beings instead of a sinless Savior? I don't understand. So the question is not, what does the world say? The question is not, what do politics say? The question is, what does God's authoritative word say? So I'm going to touch on a few just to remind you. I know you know the word. This is a Bible-believing church with lots of knowledgeable Christians in it. But the world says that abortion is a woman's right to choose, doesn't it? That's what it says. That's the world's narrative right now. This will be challenging to some people. I said this to my church Sunday. But I can't be silent anymore, my friends. I cannot be silent. I feel the pressure, but I'm not eating from the king's table. I just want you to know I can't do it. The world says abortion is a woman's right to choose. That's the narrative. You notice they always focus on the woman. They never focus on the child. Changing language so that you don't feel the emotion of the truth. My question is, what does God's word say? God's word tells me that in Jeremiah 1:5, before you were even in the womb, I knew you. People always argue over, when does life start? I don't know, but I mean, I'm not a scientist. I'm not a doctor, but I can tell you this much. God's already making plans for you even enter the womb. So why is the debate over the womb? So my Bible says, Psalms 119, come on, David said, you knit me together in my mother's womb. You know, the word knit in the Hebrew means needlework and embroidery. Can you imagine? Just with me, just travel with me for a second. And I know this is maybe challenging to some, but I want you to hear me. This is my heart tonight. We have to follow Scripture. We got to follow the word. So think about this for a moment. If that's true, if we believe Scripture is true in Psalms 119, David said, you knit me together, then that means that God, first of all, is involved in every intricate detail of the making of a human being. He's over here going, brown hair, and I'm going to give him blue eyes. And well, this one's going to dance. A little dance juice over there, a little rhythm, you know what I mean? And that one's going to sing, and this one's going to cure cancer. You know what I'm saying? And as God, just track with me for a moment. As God is forming every lasting detail of a child in the mother's womb, the forceps of a doctor come in and rip the child out of the hands of an almighty God while he's creating it. How in the world can Christians be okay with that? How in the world can we justify it? Give me one passage of Scripture that says it's okay to take the life of a child. People always say it's a woman's right to choose. I got a question for you. What about a child's right to live? What about a child's right to live? Do they have any? Got another one for you. Ready for the next one? Y'all like, it got real quiet up in here. It got real happy today. That preacher's talking about some stuff. Yes, yes, sir, I am. Yes, ma'am, I am. If that's okay. Is it okay? Because the world says homosexuality is genetic. If it's genetic, you can't do nothing about it. I got real quiet right there. What does God's word say? What does his authoritative word written, come on, out of the mouth of God? You know, God breathed out of his mouth onto pages. You know, what does his authoritative word say on the subject? Leviticus chapter 20, verse 13 says it's detestable. That's what it says. And then, to answer the argument of genetics, Romans chapter 1, verse 29 says it's not only an abomination or a sin, it says it is unnatural. They exchanged natural relations for unnatural. Everybody say unnatural. So if God, the creator of human life, calls the behavior unnatural, then guess what it is? It's not genetic, it's unnatural. I just want you to hear, this isn't my opinion, by the way. Listen, my opinion's not worth very much, but God's word is worth everything, and I want you to hear his word tonight. The world says, here's another one. Everybody ready for number three? You got this? We okay? The world says sexual identity is fluid. Just on Monday I'm this, on Tuesday I'm that, on Wednesday I'm the other. Right? And I know it's, to a degree it's comical, but it breaks my heart because those people are so broken and so lost and so hurting. They really are. And they need loved. You know, I've met some of the nicest people in the world that are confused in these areas. Wonderful people, precious people. People always act like people that are struggling in areas like this are from Mars or something. And they have like 3 ears and their face is green. You know what I'm saying? Like the reality is they're people just like you and me, but things have happened. People have stories. Come on, they were neglected. They were abused. They were wounded. Come on, they were mistreated. They were disrespected. The daddy was never there when he was supposed to be there so they could get their sexual identity in the first place. And so we got to be real careful when we speak truth to understand we're not piling on people and we're not condemning people and we're not destroying them. We need to love everybody. You hear that? All of them. Got to love them all. I don't think the church has near enough homosexuals in it. We need a bunch more. And we need to love the snot out of them. And give them the truth. Amen. Both of them. Both of them. The world says, oh, I almost skipped one. The world says sexual identity is fluid. I started with that one. What does God's word say? This is real simple. Genesis 1:25-27. Male and female, he created them. End of story. That answers two things. First of all, that means when God was forming you, come on, he assigned your gender, right? Come on, somebody. And it also means because God pre-assigned the gender, you don't get to change your gender, right? We don't change it. We don't flip it. There ain't three of them. One and two. That's it. And if my Bible says it, then it's truth. I don't need to debate it. I don't need to argue about it. Because I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, and the word is my authority. So I'm going to ignore the pressure around me. I'm not going to eat from the king's table, and I'm just going to honor the Lord. Fourth and final one. The world says truth is hateful. Truth is hateful. See, that's the other narrative right now. If you speak the truth, you're hating me. You're rejecting me. You know what I'm saying? Truth is hateful. What does God's word say? John 8:32 says, the truth will set you free. That's what my Bible says. And so because the truth sets you free, you see, the church has been intimidated into silence. We don't speak anymore. We don't say anything anymore. We're over in the corner shivering. You know what I mean? Worried about, oh, I'm going to hide over here. You know, hide it under a bushel. No, I'm going to let it shine. Remember that song we used to sing? Ain't nobody singing anymore. You know what I'm saying? We're just hiding in the corner because we're worried about the pressure. See, what you don't understand is you studied the story of Daniel. You studied the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You studied the story of Daniel later on. And every single time, God delivered them when they stood on the word of God. Okay? And to even take it a step further, this is the other part that we got to not miss. In every single occasion, when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were delivered out of the fiery furnace, guess what ended up happening? The king and all the people worshiped the Almighty God. See, we need to understand that standing up on truth actually saves souls instead of being silent. We think being silent is helping people. That's not helping people. You got to stand on truth. You don't go pick fights. You don't become disrespectful, but you stand on truth. Where am I at? Hebrews 4:12, for the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates to the dividing of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, judges the thoughts and the attitude of the heart. The word of God is the ultimate judge in every single matter. End of story. There's absolutely no confusion in God's word regarding any moral issue that we're facing today. There's confusion all around. Confusion everywhere. But guess where there's no confusion? In the book. There's no confusion. God said it and he settled it. It's all in order in the book. You open up, it's all there printed. All the lines are parallel and perpendicular. You know what I'm saying? Nothing's crooked. Spelled correctly. No confusion in the word. The only place where there's confusion is in the lives and the hearts and in the churches and the communities of people that have deviated from the word of God. That's where all the confusion exists. That'll preach right there. God's word is settled. The question tonight is not what does God's word say. We know what it says. God's word is settled. The question is, are you settled on God's word? That's really the question. So I'll say it like this. When the culture, you ready? When the culture disagrees with what the Bible says, which side are you going to choose? That's the question. Which side are you going to choose? Which side am I going to choose? Satan not only knows the power of God's word, but he also knows its intentions for good. And because of this, throughout history, Satan has worked overtime to attack the credibility of God's word. Generation after generation, come on. Every 50 years, every 100, you always hear a new movement, a new thing historically where the enemy is trying to attack the word and destroy it. We know it's very interesting. Back in the 1700s, late 1600s and 1700s, there was a man by the name of Voltaire, and his life mission was to destroy the circulation of God's word. And he thought he was prophesying. It was a pathetic word, not a prophetic word. And so he declared 100 years from now, there will be no more Bibles in circulation. It'll just be a historical relic in some museum somewhere. That's what he said. I declare. At one point, he became so disrespectful towards the word of God that he tied it on the back of a donkey and rode it to the city streets, dragging the word of God on the ground just to mock it and make fun of it. It's very interesting because later on after he died, the Geneva Bible Institute moved into the house that man lived in and started printing Bibles on the printing press that he, I mean, you know. Pathetic, not prophetic. That's all I got. But here's the point. God's word is a juggernaut, friends. Listen, you either get behind it or it's going to pass you by, but it ain't changing. Come on. It ain't backing up. It ain't deviating. It is not adjusting to the culture. Come on. Every knee bows to it. End of story. Every day. The most recent attack, and I want you to hear it because it's important for you to know it. Am I okay on time? Do I need to be quiet? Am I okay on time? A couple more minutes? Okay, I just don't know what the time frame is. I want to make sure I'm respectful. The most recent attack from the enemy has been to attack specific words and topics in translation. And that's what's happening recently. The new thing is we're needle picking. We're picking out specific topics, sensitive topics in the culture. And they're going to the translation and saying, well, that's not really what that word says. It's not really what it means. See, when it's translated, it can mean this or this. And you know what I'm saying? And if you go to enough people, you'll find somebody that tells you what you want to hear, right? And so what's happening is people are trying to attack translations and specific words to make the meaning of Scripture mean something it isn't supposed to mean, so we can justify things that we know don't line up with the word of God. In an attempt to edit or remove those things from the Bible in these areas. You know, the Bible tells us in Revelations 22:18-19, and I know it specifically addresses Revelation itself, but I love this passage. It says that it warns us. It warns us against editing the book. It warns us against changing things in the Bible. And it tells us that if you add anything to the book of this prophecy, or if you take anything away from the book of this prophecy, all the curses in the book will be added to you. Come on, I don't know about you, but I don't want no curses. I just want blessings So because all I want is blessings, I'm just going to line myself up with whatever the good book says. Oh, come on. I'm almost finished. Just a couple more minutes. Is this okay tonight? Is this all right? Are y'all good? I don't want to put you to sleep. I don't need a pea shooter, do I? No Peter? Okay. You know, it's very interesting because this whole movement about, like, you know, changing the meaning of words. The mantra I keep hearing is, did God really mean this? Did God really, is that really what he said? It sounds very similar to a snake that slithered up to Adam and Eve in the garden and said, did God really say that's how sin started in the first place? Y'all know what I'm talking about. So we got to be very aware of the devil's schemes that he's doing. The greatest misunderstanding about God's word is his intentions. John chapter 10, verse 10 says, Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Yeah. I have come, Jesus said, that you may have life and have it to the fullest. I believe biblical boundaries that I'm talking about tonight are not judgment. They're not hatred. They're love. Now, I know that there's been a lot of people misuse them. And they've delivered him in pride. They've delivered him in condemnation. They've delivered them in a condescending way. They've been self-righteous with the word. And how many of y'all know that doesn't work? That ain't helping nobody. The word should hug every single person. If you can't hug people with the Bible, then you need to listen. You need to hand it to somebody else and ask them to deliver the word. Because I'm going to tell you, you need to love people with God's word. But the greatest way to identify the work of Satan is to follow the path of death. Remember, Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus comes to bring life. I'm going to give you some statistics and I'm done. Since Roe v. Wade in 1973, do you know there's been 60,942,033 babies that have lost their lives? Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus has come to bring what? You want to know when the enemy's working? Just follow death. Just follow the path of death. I'm telling you, it'll manifest itself. Do you know that statistically, the suicide rate for women who have an abortion is 4 times higher? My heart breaks because so many women have been lied to. They didn't know the difference. They've made mistakes in their life. I don't want any female to beat themselves up over decisions that have happened in the past, things they didn't know. We understand it happens. God wants to redeem you. Come on and lift you and restore you. But I just want you to know that if the suicide rate's 4 times higher, then that means that's another road of death. And we know that Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. If God was blessing that behavior, if he was okay with it, then the suicide rate would be half as much or a third. It's 4 times higher because it's bringing death into the life of people. Do you know the suicide? This is heartbreaking. The suicide rate among the homosexual and LGBTQ community. You think about caring about people. Man, I'm going to tell you, this breaks your heart. It's 5 times more likely that a person who struggles in one of those areas will commit suicide. Listen to this. And 92% attempt suicide at least once before the age of 25 years old. 92%. You want to know if God's in something? You want to know if the devil's behind something? Jesus always leads to life, and the devil always manifests death. I'm tired of seeing people die. And the only way they're going to turn around is if they hear the truth. We can't be silent with the truth. We got to stand on it. God is love. Everybody say, God is love. God is love. Say this with me. Say, God loves sinners. God loves sinners. Say another one with me if you could. God has called the church to love every kind of sinner. Nicely done. But I want you to know tonight that Christians cannot edit a book we didn't write and start deciding for ourselves what a sin or a sin is not. The church must stand, just like Daniel did, on God's authoritative word. Can we give the Lord some praise tonight? Because that's... So here's what I want us to do, and I just felt like, Chad, if you could just give us a little background music, a little mood music in the back, that would be a blessing. You can do it on the piano or whatever you want to do. I just thought for the next few moments, this is the picture that I got for us, and I know that some people come from this church, and there's probably some people from other churches, and there's some people from our church that you came over to hang out, and what an honor to have everybody here tonight. I just thought this would be a good thing for us to do, because we can talk about things, but we need to do something with what we heard. We need to do something with what we talked about. So I thought it would be awesome. I'm going to pray, and if we could, I'd love for us to get into circles of maybe 3, 4, 5, 6 people. I think less than 3 isn't really a circle. You know what I mean? It's just 2 people hanging out. You know what I'm saying? So I'd like us to get in at least circles of 3, 4, 5, 6. I have one rule. Nobody is alone tonight. Nobody's alone. Nobody's alone. Nobody. So if you see somebody around you that's all by themselves and they don't have a friend, say, come hang out in my circle. You're in the circle of trust, all right? I want us to get into circles. And I'm going to ask us to pray for 3 things. And here's what I want us to pray for tonight. I'm going to ask us to pray for the church in America. Because I want you to know something, friends. Things are changing and deception is all around. I want us to pray for the church. I'm going to ask us to pray for our families all over the country, that God's word would bring freedom and life. And I'm going to ask us to pray for our children, because our kids go to school every single day. And my friends, they're being indoctrinated in Babylon by a lot of things that are not true. We need their minds and their hearts to be protected. Could we just intercede for a few minutes together? You can stand in the aisle, stand in wherever you want to go to get together in a circle. But if we could just gather in groups and pray for a few moments, and then we'll close in prayer in just a couple of minutes.
yes, God.
Some people are still praying and will. Yes. Okay, yes. If you're praying, just continue to pray. Two things I want to make you aware of before you dismiss tonight. As I was praying, walking up here in the front, the Lord reminded me of something. I want to remind everybody of this. That in every circumstance in the book of Daniel, notice the fight always came to them. They never went and picked a fight. And so I think it's critically important that we know as Christians in this time that we're wise as serpents and harmless as doves. We don't go pick fights. When the fight comes to you, you stand, right? But we don't go pick them. We don't go cause problems. We don't walk into situations and agitate situations. We stand on truth, amen. And when the pipe comes to us, we do that. The second thing I want to tell you, I just felt like the Lord told me to make sure I said that. And then the second and last thing is we just want to invite everybody back tomorrow night. A good, very good friend of mine, longtime friend of mine. We were youth pastors together, did tons of events together for years. And we've been on missions trips together. Pastor Adam Donnell is going to be here speaking tomorrow night. And their worship team's going to be here as well. So we'd love to have you come back tomorrow night. God bless you all. Thank you. Come on, let's give the Lord one more round of praise. And thank everybody for hosting us, Bishop and Pastor. And God bless you all. Hug a few people on the way out tonight and have a beautiful ride home. Thank you so much.